It's nice, but I'm pleased. 3.5 years, congratulations. See, to me, that, yes, that's very nice, isn't it, madam? It's nice. That's still young love to me after 50 years. I like seeing that, like 3 years, 2 months. Like, because I do remember, even though I've been with my wife 15 years, I do remember those early stages. Those couples that have been in relationships a long time, do you remember those early stages? Do you remember the early stages? When he was still doing all those little romantic things to make you think that he's the right person. All those little tricks, like he's still doing them, right? He's still doing all those little romantic nuggets. Like every day is like Valentine's Day. Like the things that I do on Valentine's Day, he does every day. I don't know, little things like closing the bathroom door when you're having a shit. Right? You still doing that? Yeah, of course you are, you fucking Casanova. Right there. Do you remember that, madam? No, of course you don't. Too fucking long ago, right? I'll be honest, I barely remember it. I'll be honest, I've been married so long now. So long. I don't want this to be rude, but I'm going to be honest. I've been married so long that if I'm halfway through a poo and I notice the door's closed, I open it just to piss her off. We moved to her hometown of St. John for a better quality of life. We have two kids, and we've kind of established that no one wants to hear about other people's kids. So I'm not going to bore you with the tales of my kids. And you know what? They're right. People don't want to hear about other people's kids. We do hate going through Facebook, seeing just reams of pictures. You click like, but really you're looking for the couldn't give a shit button. That's what we're all looking for here, right? Yeah, what's else happening there? Yeah, fuck that shit! Yeah! I'll be honest, I've got kids, but kids are a bit like farts, aren't they? You only like your own. I actually got married in Toronto. You know what, a weird story, I actually got married at the 5th. Do you know the 5th? It's like next door. I got married there. 9 years ago, yeah, it's quite nice to be back. It feels like quite special. I actually first visited. People talk about Toronto not being friendly.
Just to get married.
What's that? This isn't a fucking Q&A, mate. You can talk to me after the game. I need to pay good money for the fucking joke. So, yes. Long story, I'll tell you. Did I misread the ticket? It said Q&A. I first visited Toronto 15 years ago, actually, and people said, oh, it's not very friendly for Canada. Compared to England, this is the friendliest place on earth, right? England is a fucking horrible place. Like, you go out in a pub in England, you have to, like, you try not to make eye contact, you're scared walking through, because there's always someone there spoiling for a fight, waiting for you to look at them and go, are you looking at my bird? Did you spill my pint? Do you want a fucking fight? Right? Like, the kind of, this kind of bloke, basically, yeah. Like, quite, you know, hard slash gay, like that kind of boy. Because, you know, it was lunchtime. And now, I'm in this restaurant, I fucked off my face, and I'm stumbling through the restaurant, trying not to make eye contact, thinking I can't get in a fight. First time meeting my girlfriend's friends since I can't fuck this up. So I'm stumbling through, trying to keep myself to myself, right? I didn't notice there was a guy sat there eating a bowl of pasta with the back of his chair up. Like, you know the way you tell your kids not to do, right? He sat there, I come stumbling through, accidentally knock the back of his chair, the guy's face goes flying forward, straight into the bowl of pasta, flies back, bashes the back of his head on the floor. I'm thinking, oh shit, it's going to be a fight, how embarrassing. This guy looks up at me, face covered in pasta, and goes, sorry! I thought I could live here. I'm 15 years later, my dream came true. I'm now a permanent resident of the Canadia. Lovely.
Good times, mate.
I do struggle a bit. There are lots of changes. I don't know if I need to tell you this. There's lots of changes between living in London, England, to living in St. John, New Brunswick. Lots of changes. But the thing I wasn't aware of is there's lots of word differences between North America and England. For example, right, I'll give you an example. Here, like trousers here are called pants, aren't they? Pants, right? In England, pants are the underpants. That made my first doctor's appointment pretty fucking awkward. When I went to see my wife's family doctor, Dr. Scott, the only doctor in St. John, with my injured knee, and he said, take off your pants, I'll be back in a minute. So I thought, well, I didn't know. For all I knew, he was going to do that tappy tappy thing. Right? You must have had the tappy tappy, right? You know when the doctor goes, the tappy tappy? You have the tappy tappy? And the doctor is like, is this just in St. John? Tappy tappy. I'm a molester. I did a tappy tappy where they check you've got two balls. I don't know. Good way of keeping Hitler out, I suppose. I don't know. Anyway, I didn't know. I thought maybe he's going to check that as well, right? So I take off my trousers, as I would call them, then I take off my pants, or as you would call them, underpants. So I'm standing there in the middle of his office, and I'm a bit awkward, right? Now, don't judge me on this, but we're friends, right? I'm going to be honest. I was standing there, and I felt like it was going to be a bit awkward. I had a t-shirt on hanging down to him. I thought it's going to be a bit awkward if he's going to prolong this agony, if he walks in and I have to go... So I thought, I'm going to save us all time, do the obvious, right, and take off the t-shirt as well. It made sense at the time, right, it made perfect sense. So I'm standing in the middle of Dr. Scott's office, the family doctor in St. John. Completely naked. I say that, I kept my socks on, I'm not a fucking barbarian. There's limits, isn't there, right? You've got to keep a bit of dignity, right? So, I'm standing there in my socks, and I didn't know quite how to stand, right? Because I'm not a cocky, arrogant type. I'm not like you. Like you, right? If it was you, right? Like, I mean this as a compliment. You would stand there like this.
Fucking compliment.
Come on, Doc.
Right? You would probably do that. You'd do that thing, right?
Yeah. That's a good tip for later, mate. Actually. That's a good tip. When she goes to the bathroom, you do that thing where you just strip off, and then you know, she walks out and just go. Women love that. I've been dating for 15 years, you can tell. But that was never popular, was it? Have you ever done that? No. Where was I? Dr. Scott. So I'm standing there, naked, and I thought, well, I don't want to. So I thought to myself, well, maybe what I'll do is I'll turn around so when he walks in, like, this isn't the first thing he sees. So I stand like this. And I'm there like this for about 3 minutes. And then I realise, actually, this just looks a bit coy. Like I'm being flirtatious. Like he's going to walk in, I'm going to be like, hey, Doc. I didn't expect you to show up, right? So I didn't want that, so I thought, then I thought, well, I may as well try to sit down in his chair. But then I thought, that's even worse, he walks in, and I have to do the bloody basic instinct on him, right? That's not, how we want to go. So in the end, I just I opted for the standard, the classic.
Classic.
I stood there for a few minutes like that. And eventually walked in. Now, I think being naked for that long alone in someone else's office had sent me a bit loopy. And I am embarrassed about this, but I, in the interest of honesty, I will tell you what I did. And to this day, I don't think I'll ever live this down, especially given he didn't even expect me to have these things on. He walks in the room, and I guess I thought it might be funny. I don't know. He walks in, and I do this. And now I'm banned from the only doctor in St. John's. There's a lot of word differences, I understand that here in North America, is fag like a homophobic term used to describe homosexuals here? That's very naughty, you shouldn't do that. Because, especially because in England, the fag is a cigarette. Do you know that? In England, the fag is a cigarette. When I arrived here, I had no idea of the difference. I was trying to explain to people how much I smoke by saying that my lips have been on the butts of more fags than Freddie Mercury. You're welcome. And I'm still getting caught out now. Right? I've been here a year and a half. Right? I thought I had this shit nailed. I learned the thing about the pants, okay, I get the facts, I got it. I thought I'd learned them all. And then 3 weeks ago, a guy I've been doing a bit of work with, right, comes up to me and he goes, "Oi, James, do you want to go and watch midget hockey?" I said, "You fucking what?" "Do you want to watch midget hockey?" I said, "Fuck yes!" I said, "Hockey, I was having a bit of trouble getting into. Fucking midgets! Sign me up!" Now, I don't know if you're in on this scam, right? But I went to watch midget hockey, do you know this? I went to... No fucking midgets! They don't do this to you in other countries, right? 18 years ago, I was backpacking around Indonesia. Guy came up to me in the street, he goes, "Hey, crazy English. I went, "Yeah?" And he goes, "Do you want to watch midget wrestling?" I said, "Fuck yes, not disappointing at all." Another big difference is, in England, right, if you go to someone's house for dinner, I don't know if it's the same in Toronto, it's probably not, because this is a civilised land, but in New Brunswick, you have to get used to odd things. Like in England, if I went to someone's house for dinner, and they said to me, "James, would you like a glass of wine?" And I said, "I'd love a glass of wine, thanks very much." You know what they would do? They would leave the room, get a glass of wine, come back, give me a glass of wine. End of story, right? In New Brunswick, whole different beast, right? You go to someone's house for dinner, and they say, "Would you like a glass of wine?" And you say, "I'd love a glass of wine, thanks very much." There's a sentence they will say that will make your heart drop, and that sentence is, "I made it myself!" Guess what, Auntie Brenda? I don't want any of your just add watered poison Kool-Aid moonshine, thanks very much! Buy a bottle, you cheap bastard! As a newcomer here, I used to have to, I was travelling around the country doing shows when I first got here, and I was having to use a website called TripAdvisor to find out where to go. Does anyone here use TripAdvisor? Yes, oh, Michelle does. Oh, Michelle, do you write the reviews or do you read them? Do you have your written one? No, because it's odd, right? You, when you're going for TripAdvisor reviews, you go to a city and you think you can trust it, but you find it seems like there's a lot of fuckwits out there. Do you find that, right? So I'm trying to ascertain, I'm new in town here, I'm trying to ascertain the veracity of TripAdvisor. So I've brought with me tonight TripAdvisor Toronto, and you're going to tell me if this shit's right. Are we down with this? Yeah. Right, so who can guess? So if those of you don't know, TripAdvisor is a website that anyone in the world can review anywhere in the world. So you go to Paris, you write a five-star review of the Louvre, and it formulates a list of like the top 100 things to do in that city based on those reviews. So who can guess what the number one best thing to do in all of Toronto is, according to the reviews on TripAdvisor? CN Tower. Spot on, you would think so. It's fucking ninth. Number one is actually Toronto Island Park. There you go, fucking TripAdvisor. Now you guys don't have to like Toronto Island Park. You're Torontonians. It's your park. right? However, what you don't want is fucking people. There's obviously lots of nice reviews to get its number one spot. You know, this is a beautiful island, a wonderful day out, a Toronto jewel. However, amidst all of this glory, there is a review here from Dave from London, England. Fuck those guys. Dave from London, England's come a long way. He's come to your park, right? You can diss it. You don't want other people dissing it. He has given Toronto Island Park one star, subject line, terrible. What could possibly have gone wrong? Let's find out, shall we? I was very excited about visiting Toronto Island Park, having heard wonderful things about it from the concierge in the hotel and from the guidebook. However, when I arrived, it was raining.
Yeah, come on,
it's not weather advisor, you prick! Fuck off back to London! Well, tell me about the long, flowery ones, like the frustrated novelist going, I woke this morning feeling happy, and other people just put like one sentence ones, like, it's shit. This is my favourite, right? Someone's gone to Toronto Island Park, they've given it 3 stars, which kind of means they're on the fence, they neither like or dislike it, and you might wonder why. The 3-sentence review explains that, pretty, but closed. This next bloke, I'm embarrassed to say, is actually from St. John, where I now live. Right, this is Clive from St. John. He has given it, he says, very nice park in the subject line, but his review says, this is one of the best places to relax or do something. However, I was attacked by one of the swans. But it was probably my fault. What are you doing, you dick? Have you trying to fuck a swan? Don't put it on TripAdvisor, you dick! Should we carry on with this one? Who wants to hazard a guess what number 2 is?
Hockey Hall of Fame.
Hockey Hall of Fame, you would think so. Doesn't even make the top 20. Number 2 is the Ago. Oh, it is. The Ago. The Art Gallery of Ontario. H-E, oh sorry, H-E. New in town, don't patronise me. Do my fucking best here, alright, don't worry, sir. Look at all this new shit, you talk down to me like I'm a piece of shit, stupid Englishman from fucking St. John. I'm joking, mate, I'm joking, thank you. Didn't really want to touch my hand there, did you? Touched my hand rather like the Queen might touch a hobo's cock. And I've been to Buckingham Palace! Where were we? I'll carry on. The AGO, so it's not to piss him off again. Lots of nice reviews. Excellent gallery, beautiful day out. However, Dawn from Calgary has come in. Right.
Dawn!
Yes, I know. It's a lovely bit of Calgary. However, Dawn has come all this way. She has given it 1 star. Subject line, disappointed. Ooh. What could possibly have gone wrong? Let's find out, shall we? I was told so many things about the Art Gallery of Ontario that I brought my whole family here expecting a wonderful day out. However, there is nothing to do here if you don't like art. Who are these people? But that pales into comparison with this next one, which I just absolutely love. This girl calls herself Dream Girl. She's from Northampton, England. Her subject line just says, Picasso. Right? Picasso. The review says this. We went here and saw the Picasso exhibit that they had on, but he's not as good as he thinks he is. You hear that all the time, don't you? Fucking Picasso banging on about how fucking good he is. Someone shut that bastard up! What to the CN Tower now, CN Tower.
Again, lots of nice reviews of the CN Tower.
Sorry, some of these I haven't fucking read yet, so... again, I don't know why people bother posting this. It's weird. Now, all the idiot ones are actually people from England. Caroline from London, England, she's put, it's just another tall building. And it's really expensive, so just look at it from afar. Does that defeat the fucking object? This person, I don't think it's fair that they complain. This person is actually from Ontario. Actually from Whitby.
Knock it.
Oh, knock it.
Living the fucking dream, right? I've been to Whitby, right? Who was it in Whitby that basically went, you know what? Let's build one house and then build 10,000 more exactly the same. Just an observation, not that funny. As well. CN Tower. One star, again, one star. Subject line is awful. And you think, oh, well, what could possibly have gone wrong? Let's find out. I'm scared of heights and had a panic attack. It's not for you! I love this one from Hyde Park is 10, right? And this review just jumped out at me. Someone's just written, lovely nature and bushy easy access. Bear that in mind. Actually, some bastard, right, has put this right. For Hyde Park, what's that? Not allowed secrets round here, madam. What was it? Deciding which one of you is going to fuck me first. I've been out of the dating game a while. I don't know if those kind of lines work. Try that one later, mate. You can have a listen to it and see what happens. Stop talking. Hyde Park, yeah, someone here's put on totally overrated. There is a lot of crime in this park because of all the poor people that go here. I don't like seeing them, so I don't go. Now, you won't be surprised to hear that this asshole lives in Rosedale. Anyway, this is the last one I'm going to read you. This one isn't from Toronto, but it is bar none my favourite TripAdvisor review of all time. This is actually about a zoo in St. John called Cherry Brook Zoo. Has anybody heard of Cherry Brook Zoo? Have you, been to Cherry Brook? You guys from New Brunswick? Whereabouts in New Brunswick are you from? You're from St. John in the house! So you guys have been here a year. Have you just about got the smell of shit out of your hair yet? It's nice. I mean, I've been to Cherry Brook Zoo with my kids. We actually went a few weeks ago. They did enjoy seeing both animals. I think the day we went, there was a cat and a snake. But between you and I don't think they were actually working there. Now, they can back me up. This is a review of Cherry Brook Zoo. It's written by a woman called Pat, who's from Sussex, New Brunswick. Now, you obviously know Sussex. Right? Those of you that don't know Sussex, New Brunswick, it basically makes St. John look like downtown New York. This is a place, my wife has family there, I don't mind going there, but that's only because I'm a big fan of the film Deliverance. Now, Pat from Sussex has come to Cherry Brook Zoo. Now, I won't say this, right? I might laugh at some of these TripAdvisor reviews, these idiots that go on and post stupid things, but at least it's up to the minute information. You might be an idiot, right? You might have the wrong opinion, but at least it's up to the minute information. With that in mind, I want to read you Pat from Sussex's review of Cherry Brook Zoo. It starts thus. The one and only time I went there, which was about 38 years ago. Went down 38 years ago that is worth saving till now to post on the internet. This better be bloody good, Pat. You better have been, I don't know, fingered by a panda or something. Right,
Don't be wasting our time with this, Pat. The one and only time I went there, which was about 38 years ago, the fence was a bit loose around the lions. Guess what, Pat? 38 years have gone by, no fucking lions have escaped. So I'm thinking there's nothing wrong with the fence. The one and only time I went there, which was 38 years ago, the fence was a bit loose around the lions. The lions charged at the fence and it moved a little bit. My son was 2 at the time in a stroller and it scared us so much we never went back. He's 40 now! I think it's time to let it go, Pat! I mean, I hold a grudge as much as the next man, but 40 years holding a grudge over a wobbly fence? And what the fuck hell was Pat thinking, right, all those years ago, right? She's driving, this was posted 2 years ago, so really it's 40 years ago, right? She's driving back to Sussex on the highway from St. John's, right? Driving along, kid fucking crying in the back over a wobbly fence. She's driving along going, brrr, bloody fence. Wobbly it was. If only there was some kind of public forum with which I could share this information. And she bided her time. Sat in Sussex twiddling her thumbs. 38 years go by. And 2 years ago when the internet arrives in Sussex. It was at last, I shall have my say! I spent a lot of time in Newfoundland doing shows there. Have you been to Newfoundland? Love Newfoundland. The weird thing with Newfoundland is it seems like the places have been named by a porn company, right? Have you seen the terrible? I got given the tour schedule. I thought I was given someone's sex shop shopping list, right? First night of the tour was in a place called Dildo. Absolutely true. Second night of the tour was a place called Spread Eagle. Third night, I shit you not, absolutely caught a place. It's called Come By Chance. I said, I don't mind going there because I'm a gambling man. Another place I had to go was a place called Sydney, Nova Scotia. Again. Oh, you're from Sydney, Nova Scotia?
No, I just went one time.
What's that?
I just went there one time.
You went there one time? Fantastic. This could be a long fucking night if you cheered noise that you've heard before. Did you have fun there, madam, in Sydney, Nova Scotia? No. Was it okay? Yeah, it's okay. I drove through the worst snowstorm in New Brunswick history just to get the fuck out of there. They said, do not leave your house, right? I did the show and I'm like, fuck it, we're going to take our chances. I've got to die. Anyway, we get to Sydney and I get into the elevator. We're staying in the same hotel as a lot of the audience. I get into the elevator and a woman hears my accent and goes, oh, English, are you the comedian tonight? I said, no, there's loads of English people coming to Sydney, Nova Scotia on fucking holiday. Of course I am, right? They can fly to New York from London for $200, but they're gonna spend $2,000 taking 5 planes just to get to Sydney, Nova Scotia. That's how it works. Anyway, she said the honest thing. I don't want this to be a rude set. I'm just gonna tell you what she said, right? She said, oh, good, I'm glad I've got you. Can I ask you a favor? I said, okay. This is honest to God what she says. She goes, do you mind not doing any vagina jokes tonight? I said, I don't normally do requests. Do you mind me asking why you don't want me to do any vagina jokes? No, she said, not at all. She said, it's because I'm a gynecologist and I have to look at 100 vaginas a day. What do you say to that? Now, I'm an awkward person. I now know what I should have said was absolutely nothing. What accidentally came out of my mouth was, blimey. 10 minutes ago, I thought I had the best job in the world. A lot of shit goes down at home that people don't talk about. Like, people tell funny stories about their kids, but they never talk about the reality of it. Like, are you guys parents?
You are? How many do you have? One. How old?
Seven.
Wonderful. So you will be able to relate to this. And I don't want to reveal the secrets of being a parent, but this shit happens that you don't talk about, right? For example, every parent, when your kid's like 2 or 3 years old, has had the debate, the kid keeps coming in your bed, it's hard to keep up the sexy time. We've all had the debate, how old is too old to fuck in the bed with the kid there, right? Everyone's out the debate. I mean, he's asleep, right? If you don't do it, then it's never. And so you go, right, we're just going to do it. I mean, I'm pushing it. Mine's almost six. I'm pushing it now, right? But no one ever talks about this. This is the reality of being a parent. You have to find the time, and if it means the kids are sleeping in the room, so be it. Now, I want to tell you something that happened to me. Don't judge me on this, but I'm just sharing this because I want to... Honesty is the key to what I do, right? Now, one of the things that I enjoy most about being living in St. John and having more time around is in the evenings, I have a bath with my two sons, right? I'm not ashamed of that. It's a fun thing. All of my friends in London who are working round the clock all the time never get to do that. They do it once a year on holiday. And I can't believe how lucky you are. You get to have a bath with your kids most nights. Nothing wrong with that. I'm not ashamed of it. 5-year-old and 2-year-old. We're in the bath every night. We muck around. It's lads having lads time, right? You can have a fucking pin drop in here right now. Ease up, motherfuckers. I haven't let you down so far. Chill the fuck out, right? Now, I am in the bath. This is 2 weeks ago, right? This is not the stuff that people fess up to. I'm sure it's not the first time this has happened. I'm in the bath with my two sons, right? Now, we play a little game sometimes when we're in the bath. We get washed, and what I do is I get up and turn the shower on so we can pretend we're back in fucking England, right? Now, I stand up to turn the shower on. My eldest son, right, the 5-year-old, thinks it would be funny to bite my dick. Soak in a bit. He doesn't know. He just thought it'd be funny, right? Now I'm aware this does sound like the longest legal defence in history. But do you have any idea what it was like having to walk back into Dr. Scott's office? And go, "You're not gonna fucking believe this, mate. This time I have to get it out." And to have him say, "Those teeth marks do look rather small." Yes, fucking flat that shit. Nobody can call it. Trying to fit in there, but I keep fucking up. I keep making mistakes like that. Like when I first got there, everyone said to me, "Oh, if you want to meet your neighbours, why don't you have a yard sale? Yard sales are very big there. We don't have shops, it's where we buy clothes, right?" How we get by, right? So I thought that'd be nice. I'll put on a yard sale, I get to meet all of my lovely neighbours. But of course no one told me that yard sales only bring out the freak neighbours. Now, I'm there trying to make a good impression, trying to make friends. We brought everything with us from London, right? I was literally touring right up until the night before we moved. So we had a company come in, box everything, put it on a container, on a boat, bring it in. Now, I used to get sent weird shit. We had a TV show going in England where if we made jokes about certain things, we might get sent that thing. But because we're idiots, we would never do an episode on, I don't know, Rolls Royces and cocaine are fun, aren't they? Right? We'd do one on, like, toilet paper and get sent Costco-sized bats of toilet roll. Now, the last segment I ever did on the show was on sex toys. Dildos. Anyone here use a dildo? Gents? I like this, you're a bit. Last night, I shit you not, there was about 12 women were like, "Yes!" And their husband sat next to them just looking mortified. Well, that's fine, none of you use dildos, I'm sure that's absolutely true. What are the chances? Anyway, room full of women, not a single one of us, that's fine. Well, this is a good thing, right? Now, I got sent this big box of like these luxury sex toys. I'd forgotten all about these sex toys, right? You see where this shit's going, right? So I'm in the yard sale, we're bringing down boxes of crap that we don't want. Now, my in-laws are helping me on the yard sale store, my wife's parents. Yeah. They live on a place called the Kingston Peninsula, right? Now, that makes Sussex look like downtown New York, right? They've not travelled much, they're not people of the world. They're helping me with the yard sale. Now, my youngest son wakes up from his nap, half the boxes aren't even open. I go up to the house to change the pair of his diaper, bring him back down to the yard sale. I come back down to the yard sale thinking this is my chance to make friends, get to know the neighbours. I come back down and Barry from the Kingston Peninsula, my father-in-law, turns to me and goes, oh, great news, James. I sold that box of microphones for $20. I was mortified. I'm here trying to make a good impression, and all I could think about was this man turning up that night to church band practice. And saying, great news, congregation. I got you all new microphones. Don't know that. You owe that, it means I now have to delete the next three jokes I was going to do. Because you can't take them. It's weird, it is super friendly there. I was pushing my younger son
around. Delete the next three jokes.
What's up? Yeah, I'm doing the clean shit now because you fuckers can't take it now. Yeah, okay. I'll come back to, I'll do one clean one, then I'll come back to the fucking bill, get her in the mood, love it. Tell your friends, come and see James Wellington, you get laid in an instant. It is very funny. I was in Sobeys, right? I was in Sobeys. Because in England, right, it's not funny. We don't have such a thing as lost and found. There's no such thing as a lost and found place, right? Do you have that kind of thing in Toronto? In England, lost and found is just lost, fuck it, I'm right? I'm in Sobeys pushing my youngest son around in the car, right? And he drops his little hat. I get home, my wife goes, where's his hat? Bollocks me for losing the hat. Says, go back to the store and see if they have it in lost and found. I'm like, what? She goes, someone might have handed it in. I'm like, no, they wouldn't. Someone would have stolen it. She goes, no, they will. So I go back to Sobeys, right? And this is one of those big Sobeys in the middle of nowhere, right? Just outside St. John, a big, like, Costco-sized Sobeys, right? I go in, and I'm still skeptical of this whole lost and found. So I go up and go, I'm sorry to bother you, but I dropped my son's hat earlier. Do you by any chance have a lost and found, I think it's called? She goes, oh yes, we do. I have lots of different boxes of different things. And she pulls it up and she's got like a big box of lost scarves. All these boxes are labelled, lost children's clothes, right? And then she pulls up, this is absolutely true, right? She pulls up a box. On it says, lost car keys. And a pile of car keys that high. I thought, who are these fucking idiots walking out of Sobeys with 10 bags of shopping going, guess I'm walking. One clean one. I will tell you the point at which I realised I had to leave England was my kids have been born and I just wasn't able to be around. The pressures of that kind of cost of living means that you just have to be on the road and working the whole time, never at home. I felt bad and I couldn't be a good dad, basically. I would be there, the school, my eldest started school, the school would phone me up asking me to volunteer for things and I couldn't. And I felt so bad that then when they phoned me up at Christmas time and said, could you be Santa Claus, I felt like I had to say yes. Now, has anyone here been Santa Claus? No, thank you. The question was directed specifically and only to you, so thank you for answering that question. It's a risky business being Santa if you know all the kids. 30 kids in the class, I know all of them, right? If they see me, I've ruined Christmas. I don't want them all going home going, Mummy, Daddy, Santa's not real, it's just Hunter's creepy dad, right? So I was terrified. I didn't want to fuck this up. I put the beard on carefully, put the costume on carefully. I'm hiding, I'm waiting. The teachers announce Santa's here. I walk in the room, and the kids come running towards me. My son doesn't recognize me, none of his friends recognize me. I think to myself, I've got this shit nailed. Right? Word to the wise, right? As the kids come running towards me, Hunter's leading the pack, and his best friend, little Isabella, little Izzy, comes running round him. She comes running up going, Santa, Santa. I bend down to speak to her, and I realize I've made a cardinal error. I've forgotten to practice my ho, ho, ho voice in advance. Big mistake. I bend down to speak to her, and honest to God truth, what comes out of my mouth was this. Well, hello, little girl. Voice then, could I? I'm stuck with that shit for an hour. Do you have any idea what it's like having to go up to children for a whole hour going, hello little boy, would you like to sit on my knee and have a feel of what's in my sack? You passed, congratulations. I will be leaving you shortly. Before I do, I will say, I'd just like to say, well, thank you honestly all for coming out tonight. It's been... a pleasure to play this, this prestigious club. Genuinely, 9 years ago when I got married, on the terrace of the pier, I could actually see the Yuck Yuck sign. I'd actually just been doing stand-up for 2 years at that point, right? And I remember giving my vows, kind of one eye on my wife, other eye on the club, thinking, one day, one day. So to be here now, 10 years later, is honestly a fucking joy, so thank you very much. I do have a CD for sale. It's called James Bond's Living the Canadian Dream. It was recorded in St. John, so there's none of the St. John jokes in
there. St.
John, it's a beautiful place, and I do love it there, but like everywhere, it has its problems, and now I have more time on my hand, I'm able to do more charity work to help problems. We do have problems in St. John, a big one. We do have a homeless problem, as you know. Only last week, while I was walking along King Street, which is like the high street in St. John, the shopping street, right, a guy comes up to me and he goes, I haven't eaten in 3 days. I said, oh, I wish I had your fucking willpower. Fucking jokes, you dicks! Failed again! I'll leave you with this. I had the best news that I've ever had in my life literally 2 weeks ago. I received a letter in the post. I received my permanent residency card. And now one day I, of course, hope to get a Canadian passport, but for the meantime, I'm just going to have to accept that I'm not yet a Canadian, but I am a Maritimer, ladies and gents. I'm a proud Maritimer, and I'm going to embrace that. I love my new life, and I'm going to embrace being a Maritimer for all its worth. I'm going to do it all, ladies and gents. I'll be honest with you, I want to make homemade wine. But not just that, I want to make homemade wine out of a blue plastic barrel that I stole before the pulp mill shut down. I want to drive a four-wheeler on a highway. I want to grow fiddleheads and sell them at the end of my drive. I want to sneak into Costco using my Blockbuster card. I want to toast my wife at our anniversary in a red Solo cup. I want to make jokes about new fees. I want to buy sex toys at yard sales. I want to do it all. As an Englishman living in St. John, I want to live in a place that I can finally feel proud of my teeth. I want to know how my truck handles on hiking trails. I want to wear head-to-toe camouflage just to go to Tim Hortons. I want to shoot a moose without a fucking hunting license. My name's James Mullinger and I am a Maritimer. Wonderful, you've been amazing, sincerely. Good luck tonight, mate. Good luck. You know you can do it.